Much of success is just showing up. And so here we are. It's cold outside. A winter storm has just swept through, leaving a cold air mass in its wake. But we have a lot to say, a lot to get to, a lot to do to stand up to the bully of belief. Now, everybody's path is unique to them. And conceptually, with words, there's no way to give someone else a path. So here's a path you should follow. Now, everyone will follow the path that seems most appropriate for them. The best way to help is to help with motivation, which is to help help them realize there is something extremely attractive goal to reach. And it's worth shedding lazy inertia and the fear of that generates this laziness to keep pushing past it, keep getting past it, because the goal is so so fantastic that, you know, it's worth it. It's worth the effort. That way, at the level of motivation, each one will pursue their path to the best of their capability. And paths are very, very unique. Very unique. So I cannot give anybody any sort of path at all. That is not the way it works. But what is important is to learn to speak the language, to communicate, use the language oriented towards truth. You see, both belief and truth can use language and concepts, but they use them very differently. So belief has its way of using language, and truth and reason has its way of using language. And they're very different, very different. So the great benefit here at this point is to get used to the language. And as you do that, you'll say, yeah, it's the same words, but the words are being put together and pointing towards something different. It's quite just like a different language almost, it sounds like. So as you watch these videos, you will realize that your path is unique to you, and it's going to be different than anyone else's path, and it's not going to be exactly what's being said here at all. And yet the language, the way of using language here, is something that you can get used to. For instance, when I listen to all sorts of teachers, spiritual teachers on the web, I can understand what they're saying very well. I'm right there because I understand the language that is used, the language of reason, of truth, of reality. It's very similar across all the different styles. I can, you know, plug right in and get it. Now, I may not, each style doesn't quite feel like my style, so I say, well, I still got to do it, you know, my way. Everybody has to do it their way to reach going beyond belief and standing up to that bully of belief in their own way. But the language is quite similar, very similar. And so, now, in standing up to belief, what belief will say is that belief can stand up to belief, and there's no reason for divine reason to stand up to belief. And that is a lie. Belief is a born liar. In fact, the very purpose of belief is to lie. And so it does nothing but lie. It believes that it can do anything because, again, it came from the idea of changing reality. So belief believes that it can change reality, it can change anything. There's no absolutes, nothing set, nothing immutable at all for belief. So when we say that belief cannot stand up to belief, belief says, oh, sure, I can do that. No problem. Just give me the time. Just let me work at it. I'll get the hang of it, you know. Belief believes it can do anything. It's just a matter of time before it gets the hang of it. Okay, that's the attitude of belief. Belief cannot stand up to belief. Belief just lies. All it does is lie. That's it. Nothing else. And saying that it can stand up to itself is another lie. But that's all that belief knows. So it's not aware that it's lying. It's not aware of it. But we are. Reason, truth, reality is aware that belief is lying, and that it's true and reality that must stand up to belief. Okay. And that is what we all must do. And how we get to actually do that is unique for everyone. Can't teach a path. You cannot teach a path. You can only motivate and encourage along the path and share language, a common way of using language. That's all important. on the web quite a bit, researching, looking for anything that can be helpful, any way to help at this time. There's a lot that can help at this time, actually. The ultimate thing is, of course, to get a big boost is that which is supremely attractive in a true spiritual way. Not a spiritualistic way. Big difference between spiritualistic and genuine spiritual attainment, which is spiritualism and spiritualistic stuff comes from belief. It's belief saying, no problem, it can provide whatever we want. So if we say, well, we want to, you know, have a genuine spiritual abide in the isness of reality, belief says, no problem, it can do that. It can give that to us. Belief believes it can give to us whatever we want. It's like Aladdin's lamp, you know. You just rub the lamp, poof, here comes the genie, and the genie says, what do you want? And Aladdin can say, you know, I want this, and the genie says, no problem, I'll have it for you. Belief is like that. Belief is totally insane. It believes it's the bestower of everything we could possibly want, and if there's something it cannot give us, well, it can't be what we really want. Of course, it can't give us truth, it can't give us reality, it can't give us what we really want at all. So belief says, well, you must not really want what you really want, and you just must be insane to even entertain such a foolish notion. So it's all important for you to not get put off by different styles of encouragement, because the only style that really fits is your style. You have your own style. That's the only one that will work for you. So really, you are the ultimate teacher of yourself. Now, there will be some styles that are similar, but still not as good as your own style. Your own way of going about it. That is absolutely key. Don't get discouraged just because someone else doesn't have the same style. I've been paying attention to a teacher just recently, and their style is different than mine, very different, but they're really talking, you know, really pointing to doing a very, very, very profound, sincere job. But I have to somehow, you know, kind of put aside my own style temporarily and get what I can from it. But still, then I have to go back to my way, my style of doing, of getting there, and make the most of that. And you have to do the same. Everybody does. You can't just attach yourself to some other style and expect that someone can give you the results, give you the path to get the results. That's not possible. So it's the ones that are developing their own style who are going to get there. And the ones who merely, you know, just want to copy a style, you know, and that's not getting there at all. So that means you have to do the work. You're not like waiting for a pill or something. That's not possible. You have to put in the effort. I can say I put in effort every single day of my life without fail. Great effort. And that brings about familiarity with the language of salvation, the language of liberation, realization, freedom. It brings about ability to continue to look within and see beneath the surface. If you tell someone to look beneath the surface, what belief does is says, oh, I can do that, I can get you to do that. And what belief does, it has you look in a bigger area, bigger surface area. Like, let's look at a 10-mile, square mile surface area instead of 1 square mile. And the belief says, see, you just did a great, much more looking in depth. No, you didn't do any looking in depth. Just stayed on the surface. That's all the belief can do, is stay on the surface. It cannot look at what it is, because it's a denial of isness. So how can the denial of isness look at what it is and know what it is? It cannot. Belief cannot know what it is. It doesn't know. It doesn't know what it is. It doesn't know its limitations. It doesn't know what its purpose is. It doesn't know any of that. It just has this unbounded belief in belief that whatever it wants to be, will be. It's the prime creator. It's the king. You know, it's the queen. It can do anything. There's nothing. Nothing is impossible to belief. And it just has this, you know, just ceaseless, unfounded confidence of a liar and a deceiver. It's really ignorant, completely ignorant. Now, the ignorance that we have is willful ignorance, because we're putting up with this born ignorance of belief. And we're willfully still entertaining this nonsense of belief. And belief will tell you to embrace sacrifice, you know. That will get you what you really want. What you really want will come from standing up to belief and saying, you know, you're dismissing it and saying, I'm not going to, you know, give any more credence to any hope, to anything you have to say. And choosing a different idea. And we're gravitating towards standing up to that bully of belief. The whole world's a bully, you know, a supreme bully. And it doesn't stop bullying, and it doesn't stop telling lies, it doesn't stop insisting that it can give us everything that we want. It doesn't stop. Belief never stops doing that. Even though it tells us, of course it can stop. And it says, oh, you want me to stop? Oh, okay, I can stop. No, I can't. It cannot stop. It cannot stop serving the purpose that gave rise to it. It's impossible to stop doing that. And the purpose that gave rise to it was essentially saying that cause and effect are separate, can be separated. So belief believes it doesn't have to serve the purpose that gave rise to it, and that it can make up its own purposes as it goes along, which it cannot. It continues to serve the purpose it was given. Now, it's important to talk about the remedy. Choosing a new idea is the remedy. What does that give rise to? It gives rise to the overlay. That which is not, an effect which is not trying to change what it is. An effect that is not trying to separate from its cause. Just that. You call it unconditional love if you like. Pure awareness if you like, whatever. It's very important to now to talk about this. And to realize that this unconditional love doesn't belong to anyone. It belongs to everything equally. And it's continuously overflowing. You know, it's endlessness. It's overflowingness. Doesn't belong to you. Doesn't belong to me. Doesn't belong to anything. It belongs to everything. Cannot be trademarked. Cannot be copyrighted. Cannot become property of anyone. It even transcends the idea of belonging to everything. It even transcends that. It is just there. It is just there. And all we have to do is simply enjoy experiencing it. It can never belong to anyone. You cannot say, this is my awareness, or that this is your awareness. No. Because it's just awareness itself. Unbounded, unowned, and you say, where does it come from? It doesn't come from any of us. We're not generating it at all. It comes from the level of cause, like all effects do. But here, we're so used to seeing effects as cause, their own cause, that we're not able yet to be aware of the true level of cause. We need an effect which is not trying to change what it is, not trying to be the cause, to help us regain acceptance of the level of cause, of causation, of that level. That is why the overlay, we choose a different idea, the overlay is there for us, and it enables us to regain full acceptance and say, ah, that's where will is. Will only, and choice and causation only resides at the level of spirit, level of causation, and not in effects whatsoever. But we need to first abide in unconditional love, and recognize that we don't know where it's coming from. It's not coming from anywhere. Any effects whatsoever, not coming from there at all. So you say it simply is everywhere with we're not able to determine its causation at all. Because all the determinations of causation we have been making in existence are actually simply trying to determine which effect causes some other effect. We're not looking at the level of causation at all. And so we're so habituated to that. The way back has to be that we experience an effect and we realize we cannot determine where it's coming from at all. And then gradually we let go of the search within effects of where, you know, causation is coming from, and then we're easily translatable back into seeing causation where it is, really is. Okay, the level of ideas, level of choosing, level of spirit, level of reality, way that reality functions. So first we do have to abide in this unconditional love, of this perfect overlay, and then we give up the search. We give up searching for where is this coming from. It's not coming from anywhere. It's not coming from anything, anyone, any process, nothing. It's equally present everywhere. Everywhere. And so we give up the search and we say, ah. Gradually we accept this more and more and more and more and more. And then that leads us, gravitates us back to accepting causation where it is, where it must be. And not, it's not in effects, not in any effects. Effects don't have any causation. They complete causation, but they are not causation. They're like a mirror that, you know, reflects causation back to itself. So causation can experience itself as creator having effects, but effects are not causation. And again, for so long, we have been utterly habituated to searching for causation within effects that it would seem very bizarre for us and maybe scary to see causation where it really is. So we have this remedial idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to change reality, that overlays all effects. And we experience this, and it's experience that we don't know where it's coming from, how it's arising, where it's coming from, certainly, but we see it's certainly not coming from here or anything or anyone. It's not my awareness. Don't say, we can't say, I need to, you know, heal my awareness. Or no, it's unbounded awareness. It's completely impersonal. Okay, completely impersonal. And it even transcends the concept of being impersonal. It's even beyond personal or impersonal. It's beyond that. And there's nothing you need to do for it to be that way. That is the way that it is. And if you think you're trying to use it to find out where it's coming from, no. I mean, as far as in effects, if you think this is going to help, you know, me find where's the source of causation within effects, it won't do that. And that's why I guess it doesn't arrive as an experience for us until we're put it in the right context. Otherwise, we might think, wow, you know, it's going to be super hard to find out what effect is this coming from. And we might feel burdened by that, overburdened by it, and think like, oh my gosh, this is going to be cause the search to go on forever. So for some reason, this experience doesn't arise for us until we're ready for it. It hasn't even arisen for me yet. So it must mean I'm not quite ready for it. Meaning there's still some temptation to search within effects. Now, where will we search for? Generally speaking, we search within what we call entertainment. Entertainment is what belief provides for us and saying, this is what you really want, instead of reality. Gives us entertainment. Places a very high premium on entertainment. And it gives us what called a so-called spiritual pass that it gives us is actually ways to try and become some kind of super entertainer or elevate entertainment to a higher level. That's what it did with me. It said, you know what, you want to help everybody develop a new form of entertainment, a higher, more sublime form of entertainment, which is what I worked on. I was able to come up with some stuff that was higher, much higher than anything in the world, but that was just a dead end. That was just belief that's promoting entertainment. Reality, reason, divine reason, Holy Spirit, grace does not promote entertainment. It promotes the overlay, of unconditional love. That's what it's promoting. Because that, and only that, is what heals. Is that healing meaning getting us to accept causation where it must be, where it really is, where it's always been. And then, only then can we function as reality created us to function. So we're not trying to reverse cause and effect anymore. We're not trying to reverse the direction of creation. We don't have things upside down and backwards anymore, you see. And only abiding in the overlay is the only way to get that. Entertainment is a distraction from that. It's a substitute. It's a poor, crummy substitute for the overlay. And yet we, all of us to some extent, can be tempted and hooked on entertainment. I was just recently, you know, going through some entertainment of the past, some of the, you know, best bands and that kind of stuff. There's some, you know, pretty amazing entertainment in the world. Very entertaining. And looking at that and belief saying, look at this, look at this, look at this. You know, this is really great. And I say, well, yeah, but it's not as great as the overlay. That is for sure. And yet we're easily swayed back into entertainment or trying to produce something that's very entertaining. Instead of using the words that help us get feel familiar enough to choose the overlay, choose to abide in the overlay. So we're not trying to generate something in our own consciousness at all. Not at all. We're simply getting to a point where we're willing to accept abiding in this overlay of unconditional love that overlays all effects equally, perfectly, seamlessly, equally. And to simply abide in that and not try to seek the source of that within effects. And so what we do is we simply, everywhere we go, we're in this bliss. Same bliss, same bliss, same bliss, everywhere, every situation. Because every situation is equally overlaid. No difference. And we get used then to not seeking for the causation within effects. Okay, so this way that I teach, you see, is different than the heart mystics and stuff who talk about love, you know, as far as, you know, the heart and love and things like that. I tend to teach in the way of clarification. Now, it leads to the same place. It leads to the experience of abiding in this unconditional love. But again, it needs to be clarified. It's not my love, unconditional love. It's not your unconditional love. It's not anyone's unconditional love. It's not Jesus' unconditional love. It's not Ramana's, Anandamayi's, or whoever else's unconditional love. No. It's not coming from them either. Okay. It's coming actually from the idea of not trying to change reality, not trying to be prime creator. It's coming from the level of causation. It's not coming from any effects, even sublime effects. And it is completely impersonal, totally and completely impersonal, and even transcending impersonal, which makes it very acceptable to us, tell you the truth, very acceptable. Somehow, I have the capability to see this, even though I'm not experiencing it directly at the moment. It's an interesting thing that I've always had extreme precognition, be able to look into, see into the future. Somehow I'm able to see into my own future, perhaps, and see that I will be experiencing this, abiding in this, and I'm able to kind of see what it's like, even though right at this moment in time, I'm not. It's very, very interesting. I think it's a right application of precognition, clairvoyance precognition. And somehow reason is able to portray it and say, this is the way that it is. And I can see that and say, yeah, I can see that very clearly. There's no ownership of it. No ownership. There's only abidance. That's what Ramana said. Abide in this. Very important word. There's no ownership whatsoever. There's no copyright and intellectual property or anything like that. None. And there's a realization that nothing has any claim on this whatsoever. Nothing that in all of the universe has any claim on this. No ownership on it whatsoever. None. Zero. It can never have any. And there's something very liberating in that. that you realize nobody will, you don't need to compete anymore. You don't need to think, oh, I need to get more or I need to avoid having less. The issue of ownership is completely moot from the very beginning. The issue of where did it come from, also completely moot. No effort to search or to own arises. Perfectly impersonal. And even the issue of person or in-person is not even there. It just is. Seemingly with, you know, miraculously, mysteriously, just is. Eventually the mystery is resolved by seeing by accepting causation where it must be. But until that time, it might seem like it's just, you know, some kind of divine mystery. You know, where is this effect coming from? Okay. So there is method to to mysticism, you know. Absolutely. My way my path has been is just simply to somehow clarify. Why is this cord? Okay. Just to clarify all this, I'm not a mystic at all. I've never really had mystic experiences, except maybe during sleep. There have been some profound ones. But during the daytime, never any mystical experiences. None. But there's been incredible clarification. There's been clarification that's completely off the charts. But I don't see that as a mystical experience. It's very interesting. A Course in Miracles talking about miracles, and one definition that it gave in there is to see the world, the insufficiency of this world, be able to see it as it is, what it really is. And I've been able to do that to a remarkable extent. So I guess you might say that I've had a lot of miracles. I never looked at miracles that way. I thought of some like peak experience or something, but actually is the capability of recognizing belief for what it is the miracle. That is the ultimate miracle, because that's the hardest thing there is to do. So I love that definition. I just read that, I think, yesterday. I said, I never, I missed that somehow. That's what miracles are all about. Recognizing, you know, what is existence really about? What's its purpose? You know, it's all sacrificial. It's an attempt to threaten reality. It's nothing but dead ends. See, to see that it is nothing but dead ends, to be able to see that is really miraculous. Because it's not coming from the standpoint of belief, because belief can't see what it is. Cannot. So somehow the miracle takes you out of the perspective of belief and is able to see the limitations of belief. Because belief cannot see its own limitations at all. So I guess I have, you know, succeeded in a lot of ways that I wasn't really aware of. Have had enormous number of miracles. I didn't think I had any because no peak experiences. No, I mean, I had, I guess you could say, you know, breakthroughs and clarification might be peak experiences, but I didn't, you know, look at it that way. I kind of was like, wow, that really clarified that, but it just seemed, you know, like, just like I took another step. It wasn't anything, you know, abnormal or anything like that. No, you know, spiritual experience. Haven't had any. I always marvel at people have all these spiritual experiences and peak experiences. I say, how in the world are they having those? I have no idea how they, you know, and I never get to that. But I can tell you exactly the entire situation of the universe and how it arose and what's maintaining it and how to get free of it. I can tell you all that because I can see it very plainly. But it doesn't feel to me, it's just completely normal. There's no peak experience at all. You just look straight at it, that's all. I mean, you know, what's the big deal? You just look at it. You know, you can just see it completely as plain as day, completely obvious. So it doesn't seem like any miracle just to see, you know, how it is. I guess that I've just worked at it for so long, taking baby steps, you know, take baby steps, you don't really feel like you're going fast, you know, nothing abnormal, you know. It would seem, if you were taking baby steps and suddenly you jumped into a car and were speeding along, you might think, wow, what a miracle, you know, I'm going so fast. But if you're just taking many, many baby steps, you know, every day, like a tortoise, you know, crawling along, it, you know, nothing seems out of the ordinary. every day seems kind of boring and humdrum. You know, I say, oh, I had a lot of breakthroughs today. Yeah, just like yesterday and the day before and every single day. You know, I'm just used to having multiple breakthroughs every day, so it doesn't seem out of the ordinary at all. Not like I'm going faster, you know, or taking great leaps or anything like that. Occasionally there's a few. I've had a couple of that seemed like kind of a, you know, breakthroughs or leaps or something, but you know, it kind of just wore off and I just continued on like it was no big deal. So, they call this path the path, I guess the yani or something, the path of inquiry, of clarification, like that. And I guess it's supposed to be, you know, a really, really good path. Because without having any mystical experiences, there's nothing to get stuck on, you know? I haven't gotten stuck on anything because there's nothing to get stuck on. Haven't had any bliss, haven't had any joy, haven't had any heart opening, haven't had anything like that. So I just say, hey, get up in the morning, what do I do? Ah, when I get up in the morning, it's like, you know, I can't repeat what I say, but I'm kind of cursing. I feel exactly the same as I went to bed, you know, nothing happened, terrible. How can I possibly get through another day? This is just awful. And I say, oh my gosh, you mean I've got to grind through another day with inquiry and clarification? Are you kidding me? Oh, I wish I was a mystic and could just sit there and feel the heart or something, you know. I wish I could do that. And none of that there. So I got to work really hard again just to, oh man, you know, make progress and clarification. It's really tough. But so I do it. Do it. I got no choice. I got no bliss to hang out with. That's for darn sure. So then I work, you know, work on clarification. Work. I try to remain calm and patient, and don't get frustrated. And the tendency is to get very frustrated. I said, you know, how come I can't have that, you know, mystical thing going, you know? And it's frustrating. And I know the time is short. We have to get this now because the world has really decided to embrace belief and embrace entertainment, you know. Which, what is the mood of the world? It's obvious, you know. It's going towards laziness, inertia, sloth, handouts from the government, claiming disability, unemployment. Take from the rich and just sit back on your couch and be entertained. That's where it's going. That's what the world decided to do. You know, it was just a spiritual disaster is essentially what has happened. It's an extreme tragedy is what has happened. And so entertainment rules the day, you know. That's what do you think high tech is all about? It's piping entertainment into everybody's home, everybody's office, everybody's dumb phone. They call it smartphones. It's really a dumb phone because it dumbs you down. So wherever you go, you got like, you know, infinite entertainment at your fingertips. That's what it's all about. That's what the world is about right now. So those who recognize entertainment is the booby prize, you know. I've really got to get going, you know. There's no place for laziness on the spiritual path at all. Path towards accepting, abiding in the overlay, acceptance of that. There's no room for any laziness. You have to work to avoid falling into the pit of entertainment. To avoid the, you know, being seduced by the goddess of entertainment, really. And I was seduced by the goddess of entertainment to a certain extent. It's very difficult not to, because you know you it's easy to think that you can find some sublime form of entertainment which can help, and the more intelligent, capable you are, the more you believe you can develop something very sublime, which I could, and I did it to a certain extent, and I didn't go anywhere. I recognized, wow, this is just another dead end, a very seductive, pretty, beautiful dead end. And so we all get seduced by the goddess of entertainment, meaning belief presenting this goal in a very attractive way. You know, however attractive, you can have like some spiritualistic guru appear to you, you know, or someone that seems like incredibly beautiful and attractive in all sorts of graceful and sublime ways that you just say, wow. And then use that as a motivation to develop entertainment around that, you know, in homage to that. And to help others kind of reach this sublime, graceful, condition. You know, you can feel like there's some way to use entertainment and culture to get there. This is a dead end. This is belief. This is belief, entirely belief. The grace of God, the Holy Spirit, etc., is not involved in entertainment. It's involved in satsanga, inquiry, clarification, and acceptance of unconditional love, the overlay. It's involved in that, and using the language to clarify it, and to get past, to stand up to the bully of belief. It's not engaged in entertainment. It's not. Which is why those great gurus, those, you know, the great saviors, you know, the come ambassadors of reality, of certitude, you know, they're not very entertaining. They're not engaged in entertainment, really, not at all. They might be engaged in some kind of religious services or et cetera, but not really engaged in entertainment. Oftentimes just sit there very quietly, you know, to reassure us that the goal is supremely attractive, that they have reached a supremely attractive goal, and we find them supremely attractive. There's something, a quality about them that is extremely, supremely attractive to us, and we use that as motivation. But they're not, you know, pumping out entertainment. So a lot of the time I spend is trying to figure out how can I make these videos more entertaining, because we're all so addicted to entertainment, and, you know, that there's very few that can just handle straight inquiry and satsang and clarification without some type of entertainment value. It gets boring to us, and we think this is not going to be enough, good enough. But it seems like no matter what I do, I cannot quite put together entertaining videos anymore. I keep thinking I can. I keep taking video of stuff that's entertaining, but it seems to come up short, you know. So I just don't do it at this point. Like I could throw all sorts of sublime video together and music, etc. But I feel like I'd be wasting my time. Because those who are really keen on abiding in unconditional love, they actually don't really want to be distracted by entertainment. They want to actually hear the words. They want to hear the clarification, which is pretty amazing. And those who are kind of on the fence, well, they kind of want entertainment. But what happens is, if you give them entertainment, they want better entertainment from you instead of just very clear clarification. So what happens is you end up attracting those who want better and better entertainment, and then you have to get caught up in trying to provide that, and you don't provide just the very clear, stark clarity and looking and seeing that is really necessary, you know, the tough work. You don't end up not providing that at all. So it's a pretty tricky situation, very tricky situation. And I wonder if it's possible to provide some sort of entertainment that is sort of neutral, or something that doesn't pull people into entertainment. Is that even possible? I don't know. I have another channel, a cool down place, where I thought I could put up videos that are just kind of have some sort of help to us in watching it. When you get tired of listening to all these words, you know. I mean, it's very tough listening to all these words. Very tough. I understand that completely. So I don't even know if that's viable or not. I keep procrastinating and not doing it. Because it tends to, I would think it tends to make one more vulnerable to the goddess of entertainment, you know. And I say goddess because belief, again, can present an entity to us in our imagination, in our thinking, in our awareness, consciousness. It can present something that seems to be supremely attractive to us and will guide us and seduce us into entertainment and trying to seek out sublime entertainment or produce sublime entertainment, sublime art, you know, all that kind of stuff. Absolutely. It happened to me 100%. I'm extremely aware of all this, how it happens. Which is why sometimes the great spiritual teachers, like in the Tibetan tradition, etc., Buddhist tradition, they actually have you tune in to these deities, goddesses and gods, that belief provides to seduce us away from truth and from the overlay, and has them intentionally work with these deities to gradually overcome the attractiveness of these deities. Very interesting way of going about the spiritual path. Probably a very successful way. I mean, there's been a lot of success in, you know, Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism, throughout the ages. Quite a bit of success, actually, in gaining actual true liberation. And they're very aware of the seductiveness of these, you know, imaginary deities to seduce us into entertainment. You know, providing sublime entertainments of all types, and they go at it kind of directly, take it on directly. You know, works for them pretty well. And there are other ways to do it. I do it by standing up to this bully and directly standing up to this and explaining from my own personal experience how it works and standing up to it and outing it, you know. Pulling it out of the closet and saying, you know, here it is. Here's the goddess of entertainment and how she seduces you into trying to work in sublime artistic ways and getting you to believe that this will help people. It doesn't help. It doesn't help towards liberation. It does not. And there's so many in the world believing that, you know, spiritual arts, you know, all this kind of, you know, sublime art and creativity, etc., is helping towards liberation. It's getting addicted to a substitute for unconditional love is what it is. And you just keep searching for more and more eye candy that way. I can be very good at eye candy, you know. I can produce some very sublime stuff, and I have. But you need to gravitate away from that to a certain extent. And keep gravitating away from it, really. So that you can stand up to the goddess, you know, it's herself of entertainment, the great seductress who is capable of you know, dressing so beautifully, like the most beautiful model you've ever can possibly imagine, and speaking so beautifully, and acting so beautifully, and having beautiful flowers around her, and everything is so sublime and beautiful, and you just say, oh, that's incredible, you know, what a great entertainment value. If only we could bring this to the masses, you know, they would, you know, be so enchanted by the sublimity, you know, of all this, and that would certainly help them towards realization, right? That's what we believe. So easy to believe that, so easy to get seduced into that. Where the real work is the tough work in seeing through belief and seeing what it's really offering us, which is absolutely nothing. Sacrifice, where one gains, one's loss is another's gain, you know. Trying to develop a threat, a way to destroy reality. Constantly offering us dead ends, death, sickness, all that stuff. All this entertainment, sublime entertainment is just a distraction. It's window dressing to whitewash what belief is really about. That's what all it is. Belief is trying to hide what it is, but behind this dress, this sublime dress of, you know, entertainment, it's like a model putting on this, you know, unbelievably gorgeous gown, you know, and walking so beautifully and hiding the fact that, you know, it's just a skeleton that's wearing it, a skeleton of death that's wearing it, a dead end. It distracts us from that. It really does. And one way you could do some eye candy, which I've done, real beautiful stuff, and then talk over it and explain, you know, the truth. But maybe that makes some people upset. They say, ah, I wish she wasn't talking. I just want to engage in this eye candy. And he says, I wish she would shut up, you know, not say anything. So it might even get people upset. I don't know. It's a very important issue. It's a tough one to resolve, I tell you, because as we're here in this world, you know, we don't want boredom. We want something that attracts us, and it's hard to be attracted to what we believe is an abstract goal, you know, unconditional overlay of unconditional love. You say, well, when is that going to come? I don't know. You know, when are we ready for it? It comes when we're ready for it. They always say the guru appears when the student is ready, and unconditional love actually is the guru. Okay. It's not Jesus, Nanamara, Man Maharshi. That those are not the real gurus. It's unconditional love itself is the real guru, because it's the one that leads us back to accepting causation of where it actually is and must always be. That effect is what leads us back to that. These teachers were just abiding in that effect. So we think that they're somehow, you know, they're the gurus. No, it's the effect itself is the guru. So, but when does it come? You know, when does it arrive for us? And so as we're waiting for it to arrive, you know, we're kind of bored. I'm bored, you know, the world is not very beautiful, actually. It's hard. I took some video today that was incredibly beautiful, I'm telling you. I do have some, you know, most days I do run across stuff in the that is very sublimely beautiful. Now, I don't know if it's belief that is bringing this to my attention or the Holy Spirit, grace of God. I don't know. I'm not really sure. I took a video of it today, and I haven't looked at the video yet, but I can tell you what I was seeing was, whoa, you know, wow. I've had, you know, as far as effects in the world, like I've seen some very sublime effects in the world, to be sure, and today was no exception. I have video of it on my camera, you know, but I was thinking, should I show that, you know, actually this satsang is more important, it's better than even looking at that video, tell you the truth. But I wonder, the video might have some value to it. I'll have to keep contemplating on this. Because it might depict something symbolically. It might trigger some recognition in you, you know. It certainly did in me. It's like, holy cow, that is pretty amazing stuff. In a symbolic way. You know, belief, what we see in existence is belief symbolizing reality. It's the way that belief symbolizes reality. Now, unconditional love overlaying all effects is the way that the grace of God symbolizes reality. It's still a symbol. It's still symbolizing it. And very different. That's all that existence is belief symbolizing reality. The way that existence is how belief symbolizes reality. And unconditional love is the way that reality symbolizes reality. You can say it that way. And again, how do we get ready for it? We just have to keep working. I'm still not ready for it, because if I was, I would have it. When the student is ready, the guru appears, and the guru is overly unconditional love. That is the real guru. It's not the person that appears. You know, some person is a guru. That can happen too. It doesn't have to happen. You don't have to have a guru appear like a person. You don't have to have a person, because they're not the person. It's not the guru. It's unconditional love. The overlay is the guru. So the overlay can come to you of its own accord. It doesn't have to have a person as an intermediary, kind of like as a symbol. So, you know, it doesn't have to happen that way. It can come to you, I guess, as you're sleeping, as you're awake, or whatever. Absolutely can. And people say, well, who's your guru? What, you know, what person? You don't have to have a personal guru, a person, you know. Unconditional love can come to you of its own accord without some, you know, meat suit as a marker. As if it were coming from that person. It is not coming from anywhere. Effects, and for us, everywhere is effects. We're not aware of the level of causation. So for us, essentially, it'll be like, it's not coming from anywhere. It's coming from everywhere, but it's even beyond everywhere, you know. It's beyond effects. We can say, when we say it's coming from everywhere, we mean it's coming from all effects. But it's not. It's even beyond that. It's not even coming from any effects. Which is why people get into the nowhere or the nothing type of thing. But there's some ways that belief uses the nowhere and the nothing, which are not, you know, which are not correct. Which it has a way of using those. And then there's a way, I guess, of referring to the nowhere or the nothing in the right context as where is this unconditional love, you know, coming from? From nowhere. And what's giving rise to it? Nothing is. You know, it's like that. Very chilly out here, very chilly. Not used to this. Our breath is vaporizing here. California, not used to that. I mean, we've been having days, day after day after day of 86 degrees here. Unbelievably beautiful. Now, I don't know what it is, but it's crispy and cool. And we're shivering. We're not used to it. we're babies out here. We're spoiled. Definitely. When it comes to weather, we're completely spoiled. When the weather turns bad, it's like, I feel terrible, you know. I felt today terrible today. Why? Cold, rainy, chilly, miserable. You know, we can't, not used to that. Can't handle it. I'm very weather dependent on how I feel, which is terrible. Which is why when the weather report says, you know, it's going to get nasty, I get all freaked out, saying, I know I'm going to feel terrible. I could take 86 degrees every day. That would be great. Or even hotter, 96 would be even better. But it was beautiful today, all the cumulus clouds, oh my gosh, the backdrops, you know, that's where I got some incredible video. Whew. Just amazing. So, you know, I enjoy, you know, clouds and the changing weather patterns and stuff. That's pretty beautiful. But doing the work of inquiry, if you're listening to this, you're doing the work, you know, the tough work, very tough. Using language in a way that is not normal in this world. The normal way to use language in this world is the way that belief uses language. And the way that belief uses language is really try to limit communication. Because that's why you have all these people, nobody's communicating in this world hardly at all. They're just sitting back being entertained. If you notice that, you really notice that is, instead of really communicating with one another, everybody's just sitting back being entertained. Watching movies, watching television, and all different sort of ways of being entertained. That's all they're doing. They're not communicating. I mean, I can go back to the 60s, 50s, the 60s. My gosh, the communication back then was way vast, almost immeasurably more than what's taking place now. People actually communicated, or at least they tried to. The entertainment, the humor was person to person at that point, really. I mean, I visit my uncle, and he was like, my uncle was the most entertaining person I've ever met. Which is still belief there, but there was at least, you know, some, and there's also some communication, you know, would take place. But really, he was the most entertaining person I've ever met. Way, way more entertaining than any of the stars or comedians or anyone nowadays. I mean, it was just natural. It was just because that's how you lived. You got your entertainment person to person, and your humor, and your subtlety, you know, and you would be there with other people and know what they're about and know how to make them laugh, really laugh and interact and stuff. That's like vanished. It's just like so vanished. It's just amazing how much that's vanished from the world as we sit back in our easy chair in our home theater and click among, you know, the 1,000 channels that are there. How the times have absolutely changed in a most drastic way. So belief is trying to limit communication. So it substitutes entertainment for communication. So in the 60s, etc., we were actually talking to one another and communicating with one another with ideas. We were discussing ideas and spiritual teachers. And, you know, stuff is very abstract, very ideational. We weren't dealing so much with effects. You know, we didn't have that much entertainment compared to now. Now, of course, then all these bands cropped up, you know, and I was in quite a few bands, you know, and providing entertainment and got, you know, hooked into that direction because of my past was heavily involved with entertainment in the previous lives. I was, very much part of the entertainment industry as it was in the past, which was trying to be very sublime, give in the world very sublime entertainment, very subtle and sublime entertainment. And I was very much involved with that. So it was a natural thing for me to try and do that again in this life. But that all went very sour and very bad and horrible. Because we're not into sublime entertainment at this point so much. You know, there's spirituality. Spiritualism is involved with that to some extent. But it's getting so crude and so crass and so, you know, limiting communication to such an extraordinary extent. You can just, by listening to this satsang here, you get a sense of what's possible, you know, among people to communicate, among minds, among spirits to aspects of spirits here, to be able to communicate this way to be able to even hear this and understand it and get it, that's communication. It's not communion yet. Abiding in the overlay of unconditional love is communion. It might be very highest form of communication. Reality might call it communion. These are just words, but it's like perfect communication, you might call it that. Whereas what we're doing here is just a high level of communication. And that's very helpful, very helpful. And yet the world has absolutely turned away from that to the most extraordinary extent. And it's just sealed the deal recently on deciding that that's where it's going to go. Limit communication, and accept entertainment as substitute for communication. Because communication will actually lead back to choosing a new idea, abiding in the overlay of unconditional love. It actually leads back to that, which leads back to reality, or causation, where it's at, where it really is. And then the experiencing it then is so rich and so perfect and so sublime, we can't even imagine it. Cannot even imagine it. I've had glimpses of it, and we forget about even trying to imagine it. Forget about trying to come up with something, entertainment like that. Forget about it. We keep trying. High tech keeps trying. Virtual reality stuff. And all that stuff. That's the path of fools. Once you get a glimpse. I can tell you the glimpses that I've had during sleep. Unbelievable, beyond belief. I mean, I can explain it, but then you'll try to imagine it, and it's just you cannot. It's totality. I mean, all of totality is entertaining all of totality, communing, it's just like, it's everything is participating in this total communion, and it's just, beyond belief, beyond imagination, and you want to get back to that. So that's why I work so hard to get that experiencing. It's just, beyond anything the entertainment industry can ever provide. Stuff that's pumped out now is just garbage, just junk. Which may be a good thing, because it's not so sublime. We won't waste our time with sublime entertainment anymore. I know a lot of people just look at, the music of the day and the entertainment, just say, just garbage. You can't even pay any attention to it. Maybe that's a great thing. Because then we'll say, well, forget about entertainment. Let's go for satsang. Let's go for communication. And get back to what we really want, which is truly entertaining, which is reality. Because it's communion. The all, communing with the all, endlessly. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. I'm telling you. It's beyond wow. Completely beyond wow. So, I could be very, very entertaining, but I try not to be. We all have that capability to be, really comedic and entertaining and all this kind of stuff. We all have a little Jim Carrey in us all, It definitely, I could be like that, but that's not where it's at. That's not where it's at. Communicating, the importance of acceptance of the overlay of unconditional love is where it's at. Communicating that and clarifying it is where it's at. Now, if we can be a little humorous about that, or maybe provide some sublime visuals, or et cetera, well, maybe that's okay. This cord, let me keep this cord from getting entangled there. Put it over there. There you go. Maybe that's okay. I don't know. But I'm surprised that so many watch these videos, because they're not very entertaining at all. It's very dry, very dry. But some people who are ready for that, must be getting benefit out of them. I know some people who are very entertaining, actually, incredibly so. I said my uncle, but there's some people even now that have the gift of incredible wit, But again, it doesn't have the escape velocity. It doesn't have the juice you need. It does not. It's a distraction from it. It's an alternative. It's a substitute for inquiry, for satsang, the tough work. You know, it's the rabbit. They're jumping all over the place. The rabbit's very entertaining. Tortoise is not entertaining. Watching a tortoise, how entertaining is that? You know, you're just watching this tortoise laboriously, slowly go along. How entertaining is that? But the hare, the rabbit, it's hopping, hippity-hopping all over the place, jumping here and there. He's like, ah, that's funny, rabbit. Scratching itself and all these antics, you know, very entertaining. The tortoise is not entertaining. Just look at the tortoise, say, ah, it's exactly the same as it was before, plodding along. So, you know, it's only those who are really, really serious and determined to abide in the overlay of unconditional love and therefore gravitate and towards acceptance of causation where it is and must be. Only those can handle looking at the tortoise, you know, paying attention to the tortoise. I think the Holy Spirit somehow let me know that I'm the tortoise, you know. Be the tortoise. That's the plodding along. Nothing glamorous, you know, nothing so entertaining or interesting or glamorous or anything like that, just the tortoise. But the tortoise is the one that crosses the finish line. And the hare is sleeping, you know, dreaming up its next, you know, round of entertainment and antics and wit and all that kind of stuff. That's what the hare's thinking about. Hare's not thinking about vetting belief and seeing belief as it is. It's thinking about how can I be more entertaining. That's what it's thinking about. That's what the world is thinking about. How can the world be more entertaining? You know, it's in competition with reality, which is a losing proposition. Once we get a glimpse, even for a moment, of how entertaining reality is, then we look at the world and say, forget it. You know, this is nothing. This is just garbage. It's as entertaining as a garbage dump. Which has a, you know, superficial entertainment to it, seeing all these dead ends there, where everything ends up. But it's not the kind of entertainment we really want. So all entertainment in the world really is just garbage. That's all it is. And compare it to what is awaiting for us. But once we abide in the overlay of unconditional love and be reconciled to accepting causation where it must be and accepting it and seeing it there, then the experiencing we will have is, you know, immeasurably more fulfilling and satisfying than anything we could ever have in existence. Immeasurably. Can't even compare it. Incomparably more satisfying. So, why waste time with the entertainment of the world? It's just a waste of time. It's just a cheap substitute, you know? And, you know, the world is exponentially getting into entertainment more and more and more, exponentially. Exponentially. We've got, you know, libraries at our fingertips, you know, more and more and more, you know, more and more gigabytes. You know, we've got servers we can tap into, all these vast servers that contain all the entertainment, the history of the world now. We can just dial in anything we want. You see, the temptation of these times is extreme. The Holy Spirit warned me of all this and just said, hey, you know, you got to, what happened first was I was told I have to watch all these movies. So I started watching movies, 6 movies a day. It was incredible. I did that for a couple of years. I was just watching movies, entertainment. My gosh. And then at some point I said, okay, time to stop watching. And I said, oh, okay, yeah, I don't want to watch anymore. I haven't watched a movie in 20 years or more. I don't watch movies. I don't watch television programs. I don't watch entertainment. And nowadays, I don't even listen to music. Because, you know, been there, done that, the most sublime stuff. And when the Holy Spirit says, okay, time to stop, because it's a trap. I said, okay, no problem. And all this was done ahead of time before these vast, you know, server libraries of entertainment was available. So now that all this stuff is available, I can say, I'm not even interested in it. So I don't get this pulled in or distracted in that. But, you know, for those who really are still attached to entertainment, oh my gosh, it's a horrible situation. Terrible. Because there's endless movies available, endless TV programs, endless types of entertainment. All types. Comedy, you know, theater, you name it. It is available to either free or for a nominal fee online, on your dumb phone, through your cable service at home, your home theater, through the mail, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Whatever you want. And shopping too. I went through the same thing with shopping. Shopping too. You know, just go on eBay or you can order anything online now for around the whole world. So if you still are attracted to all that stuff, you're in a very bad spot right now. And I had the grace of kind of going through all that stuff intensely before it was all available so that it now no longer interests me. And now that it's all available, I'm not even attracted to it. Don't even utilize that stuff. And occasionally I will, you know, go through YouTube and look at some of the old bands and songs, you know, I used to listen to when I was young and do that, you know, and realize, hey, there's a waste of time, but, you know, it's still there, but I can easily drop it. It doesn't seem to lead to anything. It doesn't, you know, doesn't grow into anything at all. I don't follow any shows. You know, before all these talent shows and all these contest shows, I'd already been through all that. I'd already done all my own vocal practice and insight into vocalization and singing. I became an expert on all that. So when all this, American Idol and all these programs came, I never even paid any attention to it. Because I'd been there, done that, no interest. If I wanted to be a singer, I know I could do that expertly. But I said no. That's not it. There's something way better than that. If I wanted to be a musician, I could do it expertly. If I wanted to be an entertainer, I could do that expertly. No doubt about it. I know exactly what's involved in all of that. Even saying if I wanted to make movies, I could do that expertly. If I wanted to do anything that's online, anything that's available in the world, I could do all, the entire field of entertainment, I could do it all expertly. But I realize it's a waste of time. It would only mislead people. And if I even wanted to be, you know, like a guru, I could do that expertly as far as a guru of entertainment, guru of belief, guru of all that kind of stuff. If I wanted to be a deity, you know, a seductive deity, I could do that. I could do any of the stuff that is involved with entertainment and leading people towards entertainment, you know, and all of that stuff I could do expertly. There's no doubt about it whatsoever. So, you know, I don't have anything there to prove. It doesn't attract me because I know I could do it if I wanted to, and I don't really want to, so I don't do it. I could make all sorts of film noir stuff, you know, here. I have done it, actually, but I just don't post it. I've done a ton of videos I don't even post, you know. Most of the stuff I threw away in the past, I don't even have anymore. I threw it in the garbage can, and I don't even have it anymore. But it was, you know, it was some really very attractive stuff. And, of course, right now, you know, there's some amazing special effects, and the movies today are just like, poof, you know, ridiculous, but I know how it's all done. I could do it if I wanted to spend the time and effort. I could do all that stuff, so, you know, it's not like I'm feeling awe, like, oh my gosh, you know, this is incredible. How do they do that? No, I know how they do it. I know how they do all that stuff, the 3D stuff and the After Effects and Photoshop and all the different techniques. I've done, been there, done all that kind of stuff and all the editing they do, how to do it, all the sound compilations, all the audio, and I know how to do all that stuff. How to record. I've had my own recording studio and, you know, I played all the instruments, did all the recording, all the editing, everything. Did absolutely everything myself, so I know backwards and forwards how it's all done. All the tricks of the trade, etc., etc. They keep inventing new tricks, but it's the same old stuff. It's just tricks, you know, techniques, just technique, and acting and all that kind of stuff, everything. So it doesn't attract me. It doesn't attract me. I don't feel tempted to, you know, need to prove myself in that way or do that. No. Bad use of time. Bad use of time. Not helpful for people. Not really helpful for people. What's really helpful for people is to abide in unconditional love. And that, people see that. They feel it. And it's like, say, wow. You know, what do you got? You know, that whatever you got, I really want that. And then you can clue them in, you know, that you have to do the work. Gotta make your path. I had a dream last night. I tell you, it's a pretty darn interesting dream. I don't know exactly what to make of it, but it was, wow. Some transformation of me, some change definitely is coming up. And it's a good one. It's really tremendous, actually. So we'll see what happens. Probably abiding in unconditional love is what's coming up. Abiding in the overlay is what's going to come up. And that's going to be extremely attractive to some people. Not in an entertainment sense, but in a sense of, hey, I want this too. that's it, right? You say, this is what I really want. And then how do I get that? You know, the question automatically arises, you know, how do I get that? And then I can just say, hey, you know, you've got to make your way, your path. And how do you make your path? Moment by moment, day by day is how you do it. Through your own effort, through the effort, you know, is how you do it. Is your own effort to clarify is how you make your path. And, you know, satsanga is part of your path. It's not the only part. It's not the only part. In fact, most of your path is just you alone clarifying and using every experience that arises. And it is your unique path that arises. And you just work at that a day, every day, every day, every day, every day, every day. All right. Very great. This has been a wonderful video for me to make, and we'll see what comes about next, right? Okay, that's it for this one.